weekend was very sticky. And this morning feels like it would probably be even worse sticky-wise. And so I'm happy to be back, and not just for the humidity, but happy to be back here in God's house. There's a part of us that knows this is where we belong. So to be here together, gathered together to worship our God, it's a good feeling to be back here this morning. And as we begin with our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you. They tell of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might, so that all people may know of your mighty acts and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. Let us join together in a moment of silent prayer to our God. Please stand if you are able and receive God's greeting this morning. To all who are called, all who are beloved in God the Father, kept safe in Jesus Christ, may mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. We'll continue our time this morning with the singing of hymn number 521, which will be on the screen.
Thank you. yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. For through the Spirit we eagerly await by faith the righteousness for which we hope. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value.
Since we've been doing just the one service, we've sort of adopted one of the evening worship service practices of taking prayer requests for our congregational prayer time during our morning services as a way to keep connected with one another, to know what is going on. And so I see no reason to not keep doing that, even though now we're inside. Outside at work, inside should work even better. We should be able to hear one another without birds and wind. So if there are any prayer requests this morning, please let me know, and I will write them down and include them this morning. Steph?
Update on my cousin. Yesterday, I got a text from my aunt saying that they moved him from ICU to a private room, so praise for hopefully that it's headed in the right direction, and she's praying then now for no setbacks. So.
All right. So Steph's cousin had a brain aneurysm 2 weeks ago now. And it has responded so far positively to the various treatments. Things seem to be moving along in the right direction and is now out of the ICU into a regular private room. So praise that his recovery is going well and that it will continue to go well. Dale.
Great-grandson Easton is doing better. Parents, thank us for prayers. Baby still has long ways to go before going home.
Dale and Phyllis's great-grandson was born about a week ago, but after not too long after being born, developed some complications, but is doing better now. Still a ways to go till he can be back. Is he at home or are they still in the hospital?
Still in the hospital.
His name is Easton, and he is still in the hospital, but the treatment there sounds like it's going well, and at least in the right direction. So continued prayers for great-grandson Easton. That soon he'll be able to go home. Phyllis.
My brother Charlie had a small stroke yesterday. He's in the hospital in Omaha.
Phyllis's brother Charlie suffered a small stroke just yesterday and is in the hospital in Omaha. So prayers for him, but nothing serious from the stroke, and will hopefully recover soon. Any just in the hospital for now. Prayers for Charlie, for sure. Any others?
Yeah, we had a wedding anniversary this past week, and just thank God for the 59 years that we've had together.
59? 59-year wedding anniversary for Charlie. Absolutely. Well, congratulations, I'm sure it wasn't how you imagined it would be.
I was not in Missouri. I was
took off.
You were a little half of it.
Well, okay.
It's happened before.
I saw Dennis's hand first, and then Mary will go to Dennis.
We just thank the Lord that we were able to see our mother. They brought her out of the assisted living, and we got to speak to her out front for about an hour. So we had to see her for 9 months, and know her, and she's been out of her room for probably three or four months.
And this is your?
My mother.
Your mother, okay. Stephanie's offered up many times for the families and the people that are in the especially older family members who, yeah, that reality, I think we know what happened to the thought process of an older person. So glad you were able to see her. So that's wonderful, Mary. Sounds like Elmer is responding positively to whatever changes the doctor's made, and that his pain level is considerably less. So it's for those of you if you didn't get the prayer earlier in the week, Elmer was experiencing just tremendous pain, and they weren't sure what the course of care would be for him. And but some medications have helped to reduce that pain level, and he's doing significantly better. So thank you for sharing that, and continue to pray for Elmer. Trying to make the decisions for here, I can't imagine trying to make decisions for hundreds of students or even businesses, and whether or not to open up all of the tables in your restaurant because you need the tables to be full to make money. I mean, it just
and nobody's happy with whatever you decide. Half the people aren't going to be happy.
Well, I hope more than half of you are happy. Yeah, definitely. The school, this is just all the decision making involved with this virus thing in the next several months, and if we believe everything that we're hearing and reading, the next year or two as we get used to whatever normal is going to look like. A lot of prayer has gone to that, and we need to continue, so absolutely. Well, if that is everything for now, we will let's lift these concerns up to our God this morning. Heavenly Father, truly, better is one day in your house than a thousand elsewhere. And we are happy this morning to be here in your house once again. To see familiar faces that we have not seen in some time, to reconnect again as your people, to reconnect as your body. You have created us for this community to support one another, to walk alongside one another, to be a family that you have called together. And we thank you for your presence amongst us, even away from this place, but your presence here this morning. We ask that we would feel you in this room, that there would be no doubt you are in this place with us, and that you too are smiling as broadly as many of us are smiling to be here back in your place. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this weekend. We give you thanks for what independence means to us as individuals and as a nation. The rich history of our country that we celebrate each and every year. We thank you for this place that we call our home. No, it isn't perfect. Nothing is perfect other than you. But what we seek to do is to follow you, to make this place all that you desire it to be, that all of your people would stand together, united, to truly make this a place that all are equal, all are free, all enjoy the quality of life that you desire for us to enjoy. You have called us as your people and as your church to take part in that mission here on this earth. We thank you for that calling on our lives, the ability to live it out here in a country that allows us to live it out with the freedom we have to be who we are. So we give you thanks. thanks for the celebrations this weekend. We give you thanks for the celebrations that will undoubtedly continue with more and more fireworks, that people would be safe in all that they do. But to never lose sight of the responsibility that comes with our freedoms, responsibility to one another, to care for one another, and to love one another as brothers and sisters. Lord, one of the ways that we do that, one of the ways that we care for one another is in the decisions that we make and in the prayers that we offer up. So we lift up our prayers to you this morning, and there are many. We lift up Jen Niemeyer's son, Ryan, as he will have a heart surgery procedure tomorrow. We pray for the doctors, the nurses, and all the medical staff involved with the procedure tomorrow that it would go well, that he would recover quickly, that what needs to be done would be done, maybe the best the surgery's ever been done, so that he would enjoy a quality of life and health following this procedure that is better than going in. We continue to lift up Jake and Terry's son, Jason, and his heart attack, that he is still recovering and doing well, but there is a road ahead of him at this time. We thank you that Jake and Terry are able to be with him. They're able to sit by his bedside, and we ask that you would keep them safe as they are traveling and staying abroad, away from here. Bring them home safely when the time is right, but we thank you that they can be together. Speaking of getting together with family, we give thanks that Dennis and Velda were able to sit with his mother. 97 years young, but 9 months of not being able to speak and spend time face to face. Lord, we thank you for the time that they were able to spend together. And we ask that those opportunities would become more numerous, that they would be able to appreciate all the time that they have together. For all of those who are in assisted living places and in nursing homes and isolated from their families, Lord, we pray for their loneliness. We pray for the mental well-being as well as their physical. To be away from that which is familiar, to be away from those whom you love and love you back is a difficult thing. To be separated even by a glass pane is too much. We pray for those who are isolated and unable to be with the people that mean the most to them. May your presence sustain them during this time. May solutions be found, like for Dennis and Dublin, to be able to talk, even if it's 6 feet apart in a garden outside. Time as a family, time in community, it means something to us. It's a part of who we are. We give thanks for the recovery that Bobby is experiencing from the numerous issues of medication interactions and other health problems that she has had over the last several months, that the tunnel is getting brighter at the end. That is and has been a long road, which still will likely take some time, but we thank you for the progress that is being made. We thank you that she was able to join in a family celebration last night for the 4th of July. She felt well enough to come out into the rest of the world away from the home and be able to enjoy community and family, the people that she loves and love her. We lift up Steph's cousin and the brain aneurysm that he had a few weeks ago and the slow recovery, but it is recovery, Lord. We give you praise for this, that he is out of intensive care and into a room of his own where he can recover more comfortably. We pray that all that is being done will continue to have its desired effect, and that he would soon be able to return to life as normal, to be able to leave the hospital, to go home and be with family. We continue to lift up Ron's granddaughter and her pneumonia, which is related to this virus that has impacted all of us. We pray that she would recover from that there would be no permanent lasting damage to her lungs or to any of her other systems, and that she too would return to a healthy, normal way of life. For Dale and Phyllis's great-grandson, Easton, and for the recovery that is going on from birth-related difficulties, with the treatments and everything that is taking place for him, that they seem to be working, but there is still again, that road ahead. So we lift up Easton, that you would continue to heal his body, to knit it together the way that you have designed it to be, that he can go home and be a healthy baby boy. And for Phyllis's brother Charlie, the stroke suffered yesterday, that there would be no complications from that, no lasting damage, that he would recover quickly, whatever might be going on. For the doctors and the nurses overseeing his care, that they would know the best course of treatment moving forward. We give you praise once again for Elmer and for the pain that he was experiencing earlier in the week that has now been lessened from the medication and whatever other recommendations that the doctors have made. They seem to be working. That Elmer is much more comfortable, that his spirits are much, much higher than they were earlier in the week. We pray that that would continue for him, and that he would be happy and comfortable there in his home. We pray that he would be able to join us again here in your house on some Sunday when he is feeling able to do that. We give you praise for Harold and Carolyn. 59 years of marriage. It is no small feat. It is a testament to love, to devotion, to hard work. We give you thanks for them and what they mean to this church, for their presence here amongst us and the example that they set with 59 years. We give you thanks to them and we pray for many more. But once again, God, we turn our attention to this virus, to COVID-19. How can we not? The way it has impacted all of our lives, for those whose family members are sick, those whose family members have died as a result of complications, for the businesses, for the lives that have been turned upside down because of closures and distancing and all of the other things associated with our very present reality. We lift up all of those who are impacted medically, financially, personally, emotionally. For those in leadership making decisions on how to move forward, for we must move forward, how to do it safely and responsibly, that all that are in their care would be cared for physically and mentally, for schools and for nursing homes and hospitals and surgical procedures and things maybe as small as being able to go to a beach, to be able to enjoy the world that you have created for us to enjoy and all the limitations that we are feeling now. While we understand to some degree why they must be the way that they are, it is still tough. So we pray for those who are in leadership. We pray for our governors, for our senators. We pray for our president and all the leaders around the world as they face what the future might look like. Give them your wisdom. Give them your guidance. Help them to make the decisions that will best serve all people, that we can get back to something that looks like normal. But until then, we turn to you, and we will continue to turn to you as our God, the one thing that never changes, the one thing that we can always rely on. We lift up these prayers and so many more to you, for we know you hear and will answer. In your goodness, in your grace, in your mercy, your love will pour forth upon us, your people, all of those who are your children, as you answer. We give you thanks once again this morning, and as we turn to your word, give me your words to speak. Open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to hear all that you have for us this day. We give you thanks. We give you our love and our praise. In your glorious, mighty name we pray. Amen. We are continuing this morning through the Gospel of John, and we find ourselves at the beginning now of John chapter 12. John chapter 12, beginning in verse number 1. For those of you who brought your Bibles along, if you want to follow with, I wish I knew what page number it was. But on mine, it's 1167. John, chapter 12, beginning in verse number 1. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold? The money given to the poor, it's worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. Keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Back in high school, my senior year for high school graduation, my choir teacher selected 8 of us to do an a cappella rendition of the Star Spangled Banner for graduation. Most of us that were selected were seniors who had been in choir for quite some time, and rehearsals went really well. Everything went really well leading up to graduation, but there I was, standing on stage with some 1,000 people gathered in the arena where graduation was held, and I choked. We got to the very end where I was supposed to, as the tenor part, hit that high note, the free, and I was nervous. I was afraid. I had done so well in practice, but in my head I kept thinking, boy, I can't do this in front of 1,000 people. This is tough. I don't want to make a mistake. I was afraid that I would goof, and out of fear I did. My voice cracked on the very last note of the Star Spangled Banner. Fear had kept me from doing as good a job as I probably could have done. I was so worried about messing up that it was a self-fulfilling prophecy. Fear, it can get the best of us. Something as small as singing a note in a Star-Spangled Banner, or standing up to a bully, or any other instance in life. Fear can prevent us from doing as well as we could, from doing as well as we should. Fear holds us back. Nelson Mandela is one of many people who is cited as saying some form of this particular quote. And the quote from Nelson Mandela is, "I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not the one who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear." We celebrated the 4th of July yesterday. The Star Spangled Banner ending with that line, "The land of the free, the home of the brave." We think of all of the men and the women who have stood for what this country means to us. We go back to that day, those days, those years. We were watching Hamilton yesterday. Set during the revolutionary period, the leaders of the revolution, what they believed in, did not let fear keep them from doing what they knew needed to be done. It began with the signing of the Declaration of Independence. They knew and understood that signing their name to that document was an act of treason against England. The Boston Tea Party was an act of protest against high taxes and the oppression of a government that didn't listen. The bravery and the courage of those who stood for what they believed in. America is a nation of immigrants. The bravery and the courage of the millions of men and women and children who have flooded this country for hundreds of years. Hope, promise, courage and bravery for a better way of life is what this nation is founded on. leaving behind that which was unfamiliar, that which was comfortable, coming here with pennies in their pockets, but daring to dream, having the courage and the bravery to do what it took if it meant a better way of life for themselves and for those that they loved. For those who stood against slavery, who dared wage a civil war so that all men would really be equal. The bravery and the courage to fight literally for what they believed in. For the women who carried signs for the right to vote. For the thousands of Americans who carried signs so that all people truly would be equal in the 50s and the 60s, the courage and the bravery that it took to reshape this country, to make America truly great. Courage and bravery to stand up for what we believe in, for standing up for what we know is right. Fear cannot prevent us from doing what must be done. It is something that America has always stood for. Bravery and courage. Last week, when we looked at John's Gospel, those ending verses of chapter 11, we saw what looked to be possibly fear on Jesus' part. Fear on his part, fear on the part of the disciples. It looked like they had turned tail and run and hid in Ephraim. They knew that the religious leaders were out to get them. And so they hid. And while they were hiding, the crowds were asking, standing in the temple courts, "Where is Jesus? Is he really afraid? Is he really not going to come?" It's the Passover. It is perhaps the most important feast of the Jewish year. Will that really prevent him from coming? Will his fear of the authorities stop him from showing up? But this week opens with the answer to their question. No, Jesus did not run and hide. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus shows up at Bethany. That any apprehension that he might have had, it did not prevent him from going to Jerusalem. It's really easy to look at this moment, I think, and say, well, he was God. And he knew what was going to happen. This has been part of God's plan all along. So of course he showed up in Jerusalem. Why wouldn't he show up? This is all part of the plan from the very beginning. It's easy to say he was God and he knew and he was powerful, and of course they wouldn't be able to do anything he didn't want them to do, but I think to solely focus on his divinity ignores his humanity during this time. That I don't think it's unreasonable to imagine that Jesus was afraid. That Jesus did have some fear as to what was coming. After all, he knew what would happen, not what might happen. It wasn't a possibility that he would be arrested. It wasn't a possibility that he would be tortured and eventually die. That would happen, and he knew it would. Any normal human being would be afraid, knowing that your death would come, knowing that suffering was coming. It's a familiar feeling for some of us, that feeling of dread, that feeling of knowing you have something coming up and you really don't want to do it. Maybe it's a meeting. Maybe it's a conversation that you've been meaning to have with that family member. But you know it has to happen, and you know what's going to come. And you'd really rather not. You wish you could put it off for later, or have it never happen at all. We stand there in that uneasiness, that dread, the apprehension, the fear. But we push through and we do it anyway, because we know that it must be done. Knowing the outcome, knowing what's going to happen, doesn't lessen our fear. I believe it was the same for Jesus. He knew what would happen. He knew what he would experience. But he also knew he had to experience it for our sakes. So 6 days before the Passover, he shows up and he begins to draw a crowd once again. There's a meal thrown in his honor, and our attention is drawn to Mary at this time. And what we read here is an absolutely beautiful depiction. It is an act of perfect, selfless worship. Mary holds nothing back in this act. Culturally, it would have been frowned upon, these types of interactions between a man and a woman. This is an intimate thing that is taking place. She is washing, touching his feet. She even lets her hair down. Another action frowned upon for women in that society during that time. They had to wear their hair tied up, but she lets it down and wipes his feet. She is not afraid what those in the room will think. She is not afraid of what others might think if they hear about what Mary did that day. It is the purest form of adoration. This is expensive and costly discipleship, not just personally or emotionally or socially. This is financially expensive as well. And Judas doesn't miss a beat, we're told. Perhaps it's because Judas was jealous. That sometimes when we see people exhibiting traits that we wish we ourselves had, we can get a little bit jealous. Things that we might lack in our own personal character, we think, oh, I wish I could be like them. And instead of being encouraging, our response is to tear them down, to make ourselves feel better. Maybe that's what Judas is doing. But also we know, because John tells us why he does this. You'd like to think the motives were pure. How much food could we have bought? How much clothing could we have bought for the poor? What could we have done with a year's worth of wages? Scholars will tell us it was 300 denarii, and a denarii being about 1 day's worth of work. 300 days of labor to afford a small jar of perfume. What else could have been done with that money if we put it to better use? But then John tells us something that the other gospel writers don't tell us. Judas had sticky fingers. Judas had his hand in the cookie jar a few too many times. Sure, they could have bought food, but he could have taken a few pieces for himself. Sure, they could have bought clothes for those who needed it, but again, Judas could have gotten clothes for himself, too. Maybe he felt the little bits he was taking out of the purse were owed to him for his service to Jesus, for being the treasurer. It was his fee for all of the effort he was putting in to be their accountant. One commentary even suggested that when he took the bribe from the religious leaders to turn Jesus in, that maybe he was trying to recoup some of the losses represented by this selfless act of Mary. Of course, a year's worth of wages compared to 30 pieces of silver isn't much. While Mary's selfless act of worship to Jesus shows her devotion to him, it is Jesus' selfish devotion to money that shows what he is worshiping at this moment. The reminder, the lesson I believe we get from this short example of selfless devotion to Jesus is that we must not be afraid. We must not hold anything back. Jesus' response to Judas's criticism is a reminder that your time with me is short. The poor, you'll always have them with you, but I will only be here for a little while longer. And as we read these words, we must read ourselves into this lesson as well, that our time is also short. Jesus is calling out Judas's priorities. Judas, you claim to care for the poor, but what about me? I won't be here for much longer. Your time with me is fleeting. If you really care about the poor, you can get to that other stuff later. Your focus must shift. You must figure out what matters right here and right now. And go about that business with a sense of urgency. Do what needs to be done now. Don't hide behind your false piety of caring for the poor. Don't pretend that there is something else more important in order to put off what really matters. Don't be afraid to do what needs to be done. There's a warning for us not to miss our window. I look back at the history of God's people, the history of God's church here, especially in America, and I wonder how many times the church missed its window. When God's people missed out on their opportunity to be a force of change because we waited too long. The window does eventually close. So we have to ask ourselves, where is God now? Where is God active at this moment? Where is God moving? Where is he working? That through prayer, we discern what must be done now, that we do not hesitate, that we are not afraid to follow God's leading. As we were watching Hamilton yesterday, Aaron Burr sings a line about waiting. He waits to see where the wind is blowing. But all the people around him are acting frantically, trying to do what must be done to birth this new nation. But he's happy to sit back and wait. He doesn't want to stick his neck out. He wants to see where the tide is turning, and then maybe he'll commit to something. I think we find ourselves here now in 2020, as crazy of a year as this year has been. We find ourselves at a very unique time. A unique time in our lives, a unique time in history. I believe that it is a moment where the church can really come together to help shape the future, to help shape society, to help shape this country and what it will be moving forward after all of this craziness. But in order to do so, we cannot simply sit back and wait and see where the tide might turn. We have to be daring enough to go against the flow. That if God is leading us in a direction that doesn't seem comfortable, we can't wait and see if it turns out to be okay and the right thing. If God is truly leading us, we must follow. We must be at the frontier of whatever comes next. We are called to be a light, a city on a hill. Well, let us be a lighthouse to guide people through the rocks, to navigate the tides. That instead of following where others might lead, let us lead others as God leads us. May we speak the words that must be broken. May we mend what is, speak what must be spoken, mend what is broken. The alliteration sounded so good. Most importantly, as God's people, may we love where love is needed most. Let us be brave and bold and fearless for the kingdom. For the time for God's people is now. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, our continual prayer is that we will hear your voice. That we will listen for that still, small whisper in the storm that is raging around us, that is 2020. That we would hear you amongst all the noise. That we would see your face and follow after you. That our hearts would be aligned with yours, our wills would submit to yours, that your plan and your purpose would be accomplished through us. We are your people. We love you because you love us, and so we are meant to love each other. Lead us where you want us to love. Take us where you need us to serve. Bring those who need to know you to us. Bring us to them. Let us not wait. Let us hear your voice as clearly as ever. Stand up and say, "Here am I. Send me." That the glory of your kingdom might be known, that your goodness and your mercy shone through us. In your name we pray. Amen. We'll finish our time this morning with hymn number 863. Of God's love. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.